Thanks for having me.
I just want to set the stage here. It's, I think, important context that a new poll came out. 70% of Democrats do not want Joe Biden to be the nominee. That's a phenomenal statistic and provides an incredible opportunity for you as you launch this campaign to be the Democratic nominee for President of the United States. Could you succinctly, as you're starting, just give your vision briefly for what the presidency should be?
Well, I made the decision to run because I saw my party and my country going in a direction that that just seemed wrong. I want my kids to grow up in America that they're proud of, that is a moral authority across the globe, that provides them with the same opportunities for dignity and enrichment and prosperity and good health as the communities that our parents gave us. My political party has departed from many of the values that it represented when I was growing up. It's become the party of war. It's become the party of censorship. It's become the party of fear. It's become the party of corporate control, the neocons, this corrupt merger of state and corporate power. And we need to unhinge that. A lot of, you know, I represent thousands of families across the country who are dealing with environmental issues. And that gives me exposure in how people live. I represent about 1,000 families in Columbiana County, Ohio, and other families in Western Pennsylvania and Western West Virginia whose lives were upended by the Norfolk Southern derailment. That derailment occurred because of agency capture, because this corrupt merger of state and corporate power. And it's just one of the emblems of what agency capture has done to the middle class in our country. And you know, by funding wars, these endless wars that are essentially the outcome of the capture of the military-industrial complex of our intelligence agencies, whose function, my uncle recognized this when he came into office, that 2 months into office, he was tricked by the CIA, lied to by the CIA, into the Bay of Pigs. And he came out of the meeting when those men were dying and being captured on the beach. And he said, I'm going to take the CIA and shatter it into 1,000 pieces and scatter it to the winds. And he recognized the function of those agencies and the military apparatus, the intelligence apparatus, had devolved from protecting our country and providing good information to presidents into providing an endless pipeline of wars and military conflicts for the military-industrial complex. We've spent $8 trillion on war over the past, since 2001, $8.1 trillion. And we spent, and that is the result, that is the outcome of agency capture. We spent $16 trillion on the lockdowns, and that too is the outcome of agency capture. You take $24 trillion for which we got nothing in return, and it's no wonder we don't have a middle class in this country anymore.
It also explains the deficit. It also explains our deficit. You can just look at the spending that we've done there. We talk all about the deficit and where the money's going. You just identified most of it.
And the way that we pay for those things is by printing money,
right,
which creates inflation, which is a tax on the poor.
Right.
So in 1970, 62% of income in this country went to the middle class. Today, 42% goes to the middle class. In 1970, 50% of income went to the super, or 29% of income went to the super rich, to 1% of 1%. Today, 50% of income goes to them. And if you look at that, those statistics alone, they tell you why everybody in this country is living in a state of desperation. Even people who live in the suburbs in nice houses are inches away from the debt cliff.
You know, yesterday we heard Secretary of State Pompeo and Clinton speak, and they were aligned on some topics. And I think, you know, foreign policy is an area I want to talk to you about, because we're only hearing one side. This is primarily a financial conference, and so, you know, for your benefit, we all know something called the contrarian indicator. As an example, in finance, people think that this guy named Jim Cramer is a contrarian indicator. He's on CNBC. Whenever he says something, you do the opposite, you'll make money. thanks. When it comes to foreign policy, my contrarian indicator is usually the New York Times. So when you think about the war in Iraq and how they beat the drums to war there, it was exactly the wrong thing and predicated on a lie. And despite Pompeo and Clinton's agreement on the war in Ukraine, I do think it's helpful for us to hear other perspectives because this is a complicated issue. So as it relates to Ukraine, can you describe your viewpoint on the conflict between Ukraine and Russia, which is different from what we heard last night?
Yeah, I mean, the American people support the Ukraine war for all the right reasons, because, you know, Abraham Lincoln said we are a great nation because we're a good nation, and because the American people are compassionate, they support this war generally because we were told that it was a humanitarian mission. My son Connor, who's 26 years old, left law school without notifying me, incidentally, and went to the Ukraine and joined the Foreign Legion and fought with a special forces unit in the Kharkiv offensive as a machine gunner and risked his life because of his compassion for the people, because of his indignation about an illegal invasion by Vladimir Putin, and his belief also that this was a humanitarian mission. But if you look at what U.S. policy has been, a humanitarian mission means ending the war quickly, reducing the amount of bloodshed. But every decision that we've made in Ukraine seems to have been intended to prolong the war and to maximize the bloodshed. And in fact, President Biden recently indicated that the reason that we're in Ukraine is regime change for Vladimir Putin. His Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin said in April of 2022 that our reason for being in Ukraine is to exhaust the Russian military and to degrade its capacity to fight anywhere else in the world. And this, in fact, has been the stated ambition of the neocons who surround President Biden in the White House for two decades. So if this is actually a war of attrition, which they're describing, it is the opposite of a humanitarian mission. And in that case, what we've done is destroyed this little country with a war that we could have settled at the outset. And we have now the indication, although the U.S. Defense Department and the Ukrainian military and government are not being honest about the number of people who have been killed, but the indicators are that 350,000 Ukrainian kids have died on the front lines in this war. And that's 350,000 families, 2,000 this last weekend alone, 350,000 families that have lost their sons. And, you know, I think about that in terms of what that would cause me, the pain if my son had died in this conflict. 14,000 civilians have died. There's 60% unemployment. This country will never recover from this. And what we appear to have done is trap the Ukraine in a proxy war between two great powers, and are feeding the flower of Ukrainian youth into an abattoir of death to achieve a geopolitical mission, and that is wrong.
It's not without historical. It's not without historical precedent. This reminds me exactly of what we did in Afghanistan against the Soviets in the 80s and destroyed that country. And you see what the remnants are of that with the Taliban taking over. You know, so sometimes these things can have unintended consequences, and we've seen that before, and as recently as Syria as well, when we did a similar thing. The retort, of course, is that if you don't do this, you know, you will empower Putin. Do you want to take an opportunity to respond to that?
Well, the history of this conflict? I think it's easy to get to accept these kind of comic book depictions of the wars that, you know, the intelligence agency and allied media offer us. They did the same thing with the Iraq war. You know, we spent $8 trillion in Iraq, and it's out, you know, its aftermath in Yemen and Syria and Afghanistan and Pakistan. And what did we get for it? We got worse than nothing. Iraq today is much worse off than we found it. We killed more Iraqis than Saddam Hussein. Saddam Hussein did nothing to the United States. It was utterly a preemptive war. We've left this country an incoherent mess of, you know, that is warring Sunni and Shia death squads. We have pushed it into becoming a proxy of Iran, which is exactly the outcome we'd been trying to prevent for 40 years. We created ISIS. We drove 2 million refugees up into Europe, destabilizing all the democracies in Europe for probably two generations, and probably resulting at least in Brexit. Now, if you look at the, you know, we're told that this was an unprovoked war, that his invasion of Iraq was, or of Ukraine was unprovoked. But for many, many years, we have been provoking the Russians, and this isn't me saying it, it's just about Robert Kennedy. It's George Kennan, who is the father of U.S. foreign policy and the containment. It's Bill Perry, who threatened to resign, who was President Clinton's Secretary of Defense, who threatened to resign in 1998 because of the expansion of NATO to Russia's borders. We told the Russians in 1991 and 1992 repeatedly and in writing, although not in a signed treaty, that if they removed the 400 troops from Germany and allowed Germany to reunite under NATO, that we would not move NATO 1 inch to the east. We've since then moved it 1,000 miles to the east and 14 countries. Not only that, but we have put Aegis missile systems, which can launch nuclear missiles in Romania and Poland, right on the Russian border. The Russians, Bill Burns, who was the U.S. ambassador to Russia at that time and is now the head of the CIA, sent a famous memo in which he said, if you move NATO into the Ukraine, it is a red line that cannot be crossed. All of these doyens of U.S. foreign policy were saying, if we continue to move NATO to the east, you're going to force Russia. Russia's been invaded 3 times through the Ukraine. The last time Russia was invaded, 1 out of every 7 Russians was killed. They have a sensitivity there. When the Russians moved nuclear missile sites into Cuba in 1962, which I remember well, we were in the process of moving to these underground bunkers where before my father stopped us. But my uncle would have been forced, if they hadn't removed them, would have been forced to invade Cuba. And we need to put ourselves in the Russians' shoes and actually understand. My uncle always said, you have to put yourself in your adversary's shoes and understand what their point of view of the world is. In 2014, we helped overthrow, we spent $5 billion to overthrow Viktor Yanukovych, who was the democratically elected premier president of Ukraine. So we overthrew him. We then put in place a government which we handpicked 2 months before. We have telephone calls from Victoria Nuland. 2 months before the coup, we were handpicking the new government of Ukraine. And the first thing that new government did was to pass a series of repressive laws about the Donbass to forbid use of the Russian language and to make them second-class citizenships. This war, and then to attack them violently, killing 14,000 over the intervening years, this war did not begin in February 2022. It began in February of 2014. And it was, and the Russians saw it that way. The Russians, we continued to say, we're gonna move NATO into the Ukraine. The Russians were very, very clear that we don't want that. The Ukraine is 400 miles from Moscow. If we put Aegis missile systems in the Ukraine, we can decapitate their entire capacity to respond to a nuclear attack and make a preemptive nuclear attack for us strategically feasible. So, you know, these are some of the things that and by the way, the people of Donbass voted to join Russia, and Putin refused. He said, we don't want you, we want Ukraine to be a coherent nation. But Ukraine needs to protect those people from violence. And France, Germany, and Russia, and the Ukraine all agreed to sign the Minsk Accords, which would have left Ukraine in Ukraine, would have left Donbass in Ukraine as an autonomous region, but would have given them protection and allowed them to speak their own language. When Zelensky ran in 2019, Zelensky was a comedian and an actor, which I'm not saying in a disparaging way because my wife is both those things as well. But I'm saying it because he had no political experience. The reason he won was because he ran with 70% of the vote, is because he ran on a peace platform and he promised to sign the Minsk Accords. But when he got in there, he pivoted. And he pivoted because he was surrounded by ultra-nationalists within his own country and neocons from the White House. And they got him to, you know, provoked him into a violent response to Russia instead.
The other ramification of what you're describing is that now China has become an ally of Russia's.
Yes, so that's not strategically good for the United
at all.
States.
I mean, if you even go back to Kissinger's time, the idea was to get China on our side to isolate Russia when they were obviously our number one threat. To me, it's obvious that China now plays that role as opposed to Russia, and in fact, now we've trying to take on both of them simultaneously. So, you know, as we kind of get towards the end here, just give us your views on how to deal with China if you were president.
You know, I think we should de-escalate. We need to compete with the Chinese, but they don't want to compete with us in a war. And we should not be playing on that minefield. We should compete with the Chinese economically, but in order to do that, we need to unwind the empire abroad. We have 800 bases. We're spending $1.3 trillion a year on our military, homeland security, veterans, et cetera. And we cannot compete with the Chinese if we continue to do that. We have gutted the middle class through military. You know, Paul Kennedy wrote a book, who's this professor at Yale, who spent his entire career studying the decline of empires. And he's done a book that shows the decline of every empire in the last 500 years, and every one of them, the death knell, was overextending its military abroad. The Chinese are beating us by projecting economic power, and we're trying to project military power, and it isn't working. It's not making us friends. It is making us less secure at home. It has gutted the middle class in this country. My grandfather believed that a country, America, is not going to make itself strong through projecting military power. We should arm ourselves to the teeth around our borders. We should make ourselves too expensive to invade. And then we should spend that money. We're now spending $1 billion on stealth bombers that can't fly in the rain. Those are stranded assets. They do no good for us economically. We need to bring that money home, rebuild our industrial base, rebuild our middle class, and then compete with the Chinese economically. And I
enforce
am
our own borders, hopefully,
as
well. Enforce our own southern border, which would be nice as well.
Exactly.
We do that too. You are, this is a finance conference, you are a capitalist. I want to make that clear. However, you are concerned about a threat to democracy around regulatory capture. Please close with your vision for the economy if you were in power and how you would take on crony capitalism.
Well, I've spent my 40-year career suing the regulatory agencies that are the, you know, the fulcrum of regulatory capture. So I've sued USDA, I've litigated against, of course, FDA, CDC, NIH, the EPA, the FCC, and when you do that kind of litigation, all of those suits targeted favors sweetheart relationships that those regulatory agencies were doing with regulated industries. The regulatory agencies have become the sock puppets of the industries they're supposed to regulate, and they become predatory. And that's really, if you look closely, including the CIA, which is what Eisenhower predicted that the military-industrial complex would destroy our economy and overwhelm our democracy. It would make us an imperium abroad and a national surveillance state at home, and the CIA would be the mechanism that they would use to do that, and that's exactly what's happened to our country. My father, in the weeks before he died, understood those issues, and he developed a plan for reorganizing the CIA to end a lot of those conflicts of interest. So, and I asked Ron DeSantis recently, when I was having breakfast with him, what he was going to do with NIH, and he said, I'm going to burn it to the ground if he becomes president. And I understand that impulse, but you know, I think 90% of the people who work for NIH are good people. They're patriotic Americans. They're good public servants. The structure and the incentive systems in that agency are what's corrupting it, and the top officials in each of the branches.
The same. Just say Anthony Fauci. I mean, that's who you're talking about.
Well, I mean, that's an example of a 50-year bureaucrat who rose through the ranks and then had this durability. Not because he was protecting public health. Public health in this country is a catastrophe. We pay more for health care and get the worst results of any country in the world. We've gone from, when he came in, 6% of our country, of our children having chronic disease, to 54%. And he's there not because he was good at protecting public health, but because he was good at protecting the interests of the pharmaceutical industries, which really control that agency.
America's one of, I think, only two developed nations that allow pharmaceutical companies to advertise.
Yeah, New Zealand and the United States are the only countries in the world that allow pharmaceutical companies to do direct-to-consumer advertising on TV, and it's been a calamity in our country for public health because it's allowed them to control the narrative, to control political figures in this country. And we're not getting healthier. The third largest cause of death in this country today is pharmaceutical products after heart attack and cancer. And we have the highest chronic disease rate of any country on earth. We have the highest COVID death rate. We have 4.2% of the populations. We have 16% of the COVID deaths in this country. That's not a success story. That is a calamity. And nobody's asking why that happened. That's what our public health agencies ought to be doing. Why were more Americans dying? Haiti had 1/200th the death rate. We were told that Haiti and Nigeria were going to get, slaughtered by COVID. They never got touched by it. And they had a 1%, 1.5% vaccination rate. They had 14 deaths per million population, 14 and 15 respectively. We had 3,000 deaths per million population. So we had 200 times the death rate of African countries with no healthcare system. Something is really wrong with what's happening in this country. And why are we having the obesity epidemic? Why are we having all these epidemics of neurological diseases, ADD, ADHD, speech delay, language delay, tics, Tourette's syndrome, narcolepsy? All this stuff started in 1989. EPA told Congress that autism went from 1 in 10,000 in my generation, which it still is, to 1 in every 34 kids today. We got these explosions of autoimmune diseases that same year, rheumatoid arthritis, juvenile diabetes. Why is that happening? Why did peanut allergies suddenly appear in 1989? We know it's an environmental toxin. Genes do not cause epidemic. If any of you are my age, you cannot remember meeting anybody when you were a school kid who had autism or peanut allergy. Prior to 1989, these were minor things, but now, today, eczema, all of these autoimmune diseases suddenly explode that year. What happened that year? Well, we know there's about 11 culprits, and it's an easy thing to figure out which one it is and then eliminate it. The problem is, there's a big shot at the end of everyone, and Anthony Fauci did not want to do his job.
On that positive note, I want to stop. But look, in all seriousness, whether you agree with Robert or not, his courage speaks for itself. And I thank you for doing that and being an important part of the conversation. We need more of that in this country, not less. And thank you for your time and what you're doing. And thank you, everybody, for attending today. Fall in love.